Great beer is about drinkability. Doesn't matter the style.
You guys are like walking beer Wikipedia.
That's the first time that you've ever accepted me as a person.
Or you have a fermentation in your gut.
Yeah. I'm jet propelled at all times.
How many guys do you think that you have the privilege to slap?
Somebody who's never tasted a commercial example, and this is how you know everything about this beer? Please, you don't.
I think it's bullshit.
I think it's bullshit, too.
Wow.
Are you guys going to arm wrestle?
No.
We're going to teabag fight instead.
Yeah. You heard of Junkyard Wars?
Can I get another high five, Beavis?
Now, live from the Brewing Network studios in Northern California, this is the radio program for home brewers, craft brewers, beer lovers, and beer geeks. It's your only source for live beer radio that brings expert brewers together with, well, expert drinkers. This is the radio program with a head on it. This is The Session.
Hey, welcome everybody. This is The Session. My name is JP. I'm going to be your host for today. Along with me is my very close personal friend, but slightly less handsome than I am, Sean O'Sullivan.
Hey. Well, it's great to be back, especially over Zoom. In my own kitchen. I thought I would never do a session show in my kitchen, but here I am.
But here you are. Are you going to cook something up for us, while we're waiting?
I'm going to fry some pork a little later and do a cooking demo, and then, we'll get into, some wine.
I love it. I think it'd be great. I think it'd be a great turn for the session to take a little cooking with Sully.
There you go. I like that. I like that idea. How are you doing, JP?
I'm okay. I'm here, man. We're sweating out here in East County, baby.
Oh, it is?
Hot.
There's one thing I have to say before we get into the meat and potato of the show. I have to congratulate you. This is your wedding anniversary.
No, Saturday.
That's what I said, Saturday.
Yeah.
And so I just want to, congratulate you on 5 years of marital bliss. And there we are. I was the officiant at your wedding.
Sure were.
I witnessed the whole thing. And you haven't called me to renege on the whole thing. So congratulations.
Oh, yeah, well, thanks, man. I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
You're quite welcome.
Speaking of celebrations, we are here with Vito, Brandon, and Jessica from Imperiale Beer Project in my neighboring area of Brentwood. How you guys doing?
Doing good.
Doing good. Thanks for having us.
Doing all right? Yeah, thanks for Zooming with us. You didn't have to try out the record, man, which is, it's not really that much of a drive, but it's half an hour, 35 minutes. Nobody wants to drive because it's the 4 corridor, and that's terrible, but that's another show. That's the freeway show we're going to start here in a little bit.
Yeah, speedway.
Coming at you.
Before we get into the show, though, if you want to support – see, I don't even know anymore. This is the hard part about it. If you want to support the show, we have on our homepage of our website, which is thebrewingnetwork.com, of course, a link to our Amazon affiliate account, so you can do all your Amazon shopping through there. That would be really great. For all the sponsors that you hear on today's show, please support them, email them, reach out to them, thank them very much for still supporting this show, especially through all the nonsense that's happening in the world right now. We need all the support we can get from you listeners and from the sponsors too. So do me a favor and support them if you can. That would be really, really kind of you. We also have a bunch of other shows on the network, but you guys know that. So let me stop rambling and let's talk beer. Imperiale Beer Project. Thank you again, guys, for joining us. So I'm familiar with you guys, vaguely, because you had a bar out in Brentwood, I believe, right?
We were in Brentwood at the corner of Lone Tree and Empire for a while. I think we opened up 2016. It's kind of dove our way into the beer scene out here, trying to, help the area a little bit. We got tired of traveling to go get good beers.
Bro, I moved from Concord, excuse me, out here to Oakley, I don't know, 3 years ago, I guess, or whatever. And, you're looking on Yelp or whatever, and you're going, I don't know where to get a beer. There's a joint, by the Raley's. See, now I can talk to you. Now we know.
Beef and Brew when you checked it out, or was it Providence?
It was Providence.
Okay. Beef and Brew was...
It was Beef and Brew when we moved out here a few years before you.
Beef and Brew?
Beef and Brew.
Beef and Brew.
Yeah. That sounds like a strip club, I think, and I don't...
It was a little weird, but, it was cool.
It was a little weird, yeah, and they had, 805 and Modelo, and then, all the other, big staples. I'm like, okay, I could sort of vibe, but you know, there wasn't really anything out here except for Imperiale. So I appreciate that. When you opened up, how is introducing craft beer to a market that isn't really craft savvy? I mean, you guys did sort of break ground out here.
There's a couple places that were into beer, but they still stuck mostly to the bigger distributors mainstream and stuff like that. You know, like none of them stood in line at 4 a.m. to wait for a single bottle of something. You know, they hadn't paid their dues like that. So it was a little difficult at first, but I think our area of just of East County and then the surrounding areas, Tracy, Stockton, you know, over into the Delta towns and stuff, like we started pulling people in. Like people were traveling to us just to buy, you know, a 4-pack and take off because there was nothing over there. So that was kind of cool. It was a little slow going at first, you know, and it still kind of is, just because we're like a secluded corner of the Bay Area, and most people from the Bay Area hate that we say we're part of the Bay Area, but you know,
but we are.
Do they really? That's a thing. Like you're part of the Bay Area. You think you're part of Nevada? I mean, what is it?
I think we're West Sacramento.
Okay.
Yeah. It's really not that far.
You jump in and
I've seen West Sacramento. You were not West Sacramento. And I love West Sacramento.
Sure.
Like he would drive down the coast and get kegs and bottles and curate this list. Like he's one of the dudes that loved beer and didn't just order, you know, like he went and drove for these
guys. Yeah. So like a lot of 24-hour road trips down to LA and San Diego. Overnight, bomb down, come back and
bootlegging.
That just stemmed from, you know, being a fan of beer and traveling to go taste beers from all over.
Yeah.
And then once you taste beers from all your favorite places, wherever they are, you're like, oh shit, I want to share that with people. We need to figure out a way to get it to them. So if it was in California, we'd drive or figured out, you know, how to work GSO for people that were like willing to do that with us. Not everybody would be, but you know, we made a lot of friends and was able to get a lot of good beer up here.
Nice. And you know, I've been a couple times and I think you had European beers. Right? Or maybe I was just drunk because my thought was anytime you go to a beer bar and you can't pronounce the name really on the beer board, you know you're in a place that cares about beer.
Yeah.
I mean not to say that, you know, if you just have like, you know, 21st Amendment or society or whatever, that, you know, it is what it is. But if you're like hauling European beers over that I've never heard of before and I've, you know, drank a fair share of beers, you feel like, okay, I'm in a place that sort of understands me as a person.
I think we were open to just, you know, new breweries, new styles of things that we never heard of just because we're fans of beer, so we wanted to try
it. Well, yeah, and beer's been a passion for us for so long. Like, we weren't an establishment just opening up, trying to make ends meet. Like, it's...
Yeah, we're going on hype and stuff like that. It was a passion thing. We wanted to do it right, or at least how we thought it should be done, you know? It worked out and it paid off and people liked and supported us, you know. We didn't kill it or anything, but 5 years later, or less than 5 years later, we sold one venue and all the assets and then dumped that back into a new venue and we opened a brewery. So it's worked out and people like it and people are still supporting us. So you had
the tap bar you started in 2016 and then you ran that and then you sold that off and then you...
2019. Started construction of 2019 in August of 2019 on the brewery, and we opened the doors in April, so we knocked it out in about like 7 months, I think.
Even with the pandemic.
We're
definitely getting there. So how do you decide to sort of switch to the other side of the counter or the other side of the cold box, I guess? How do you go from serving beer?
In the plans.
I know. We've known each other for years. Yeah. And I've always wanted to be, you know, I always wanted to brew. I'm, you know, home brewer for years. And we've talked about it. And
exactly.
I know you. It was for years now. You know, you kind of like, hey,
it just
ready,
happened,
you know,
a lot quicker than we were expecting.
Yeah. It was
more like of a 5-10 year plan, not a 3-4 year.
Yeah. We didn't know how to get into that side of it. I'd never worked in the industry before. Neither of us did. And I tried to get a couple jobs at places just to learn a little bit. And
I did that.
Over time, I made enough money to save up and start the bar. And so we figured we'll get into the industry that way, kind of like shoe our way in there. And then we started learning more about it, taking notes, talking to more brewers we met, more brewery owners, and giving us, you know, the logistics and everything. And then once we figured out it was going to happen, call up this bad guy right here. And
Vito to the rescue.
I can make beer, but people wouldn't buy my beer. So we need something like this.
Oh, same, brother. Yeah, for sure. So you're, let me just see if I understand. Your pathway to opening a brewery was to open a bar.
Yeah.
To learn about the industry. I feel like that's much more work than maybe you needed to do.
Just like working at a bar.
Yeah.
it was fun, but I took opportunities that presented themselves within there, and then everything lines up eventually, you know.
Yeah.
One of the key, especially for our business model, which is like 90%, and we'll probably get to that later, in-house sales. It's a distribution model. So like you learned, you know, 90% of like what we were, you know, aiming for with the opening of this brewery, right? That distribution.
Yeah. And I didn't know much about it. And it just seemed that, I think the brewery side of it seemed a little bit more daunting, especially with the whole equipment and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So the tap room seemed manageable, and like I could pick that up fairly easy and, you know, work it, because the key things are just like, you know, having a good work ethic, being decent with people, and then knowing what you're talking about.
Were you always planning to open in Brentwood?
Wanted to, yeah. Okay. I felt like since we started the bar out here and we lived out here, you know, we
wanted a place that we could hang out with, and it just, we had to open it.
Yeah, and,
which in some ways that might make a little bit more sense, honestly. If you open a craft beer bar and you sort of whet everybody's appetite for craft beer, well, then you can open a brewery with a tap room in it and sort of supply that demand you've already created.
Yeah, and honestly, I think that wasn't necessarily the plan. It was just kind of like run the industry and see where it goes.
Yeah.
But if we didn't do that prior to opening this, we would have gone under like super quick, because we were at the end of construction. I was calling for our final inspections the day shelter in place happened. So like all of our money was gone from just finishing construction. We were waiting for, you know, some cash flow to come in a couple weeks when we opened up. And then like, fuck that plan, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
If we weren't able to post something on Instagram saying like, yo, we're selling crawlers tomorrow, come buy some shit, and get the response that we got, like it could have been a different scenario. Sure. You know, we might not have made it this long.
Sure. Wow. Yeah, you have to just open the doors at some point. We were the same way. We didn't even have our brew. This is in 2000 at the pub in San Francisco, and we didn't even have our brewing license yet. We were still waiting for that to go through. So I just got a bunch of guest beers just to open, just to get the money to come.
Yeah, exactly.
At some point, you're just like, we got to just open this. So got to get
it. That was one of the plans too, like pending, because we didn't know like how the TTB process was going to go, or we kept getting different answers as far as like who inspects the brew house or who actually finally clears you to make beer. And so as we're getting closer to opening, it's just like, well, shit, since we have a full kitchen, we can do guest beers. We can just open up and operate like a brew pub until we figure out the brew house, worst case scenario. But come to find out, nobody else knows who's supposed to regulate the brew house, really, aside from, you know, the FDA.
I remember once I made a decision to have all the guest beers came in, and I bought beers from distributors, kegs from distributors. They gave me all this tapping equipment, so the lines, the taps, and all that. It was like, it was the Sankey fittings and all that. It was like, oh, free stuff. This is awesome. Which I probably paid for, by the way.
Yeah.
Nothing's free.
Yeah.
So you guys knew Vito since
I met him through a friend of a friend, Jessica, one of Jessica's coworkers. They were into beer too. They were
friends. She's my best.
Jessica BFF.
Right.
They were friends with Vito, and then we were all into beer, and that became common knowledge. And then, you know, I think the first time I met Vito was actually at
Oakland Trappist.
No, right? Spring Brews, I think.
Oh, Spring Brews. Oh, God.
Yeah.
Oh.
Spring Brews. All right.
It all comes back to the BN.
Dude, so much.
Which are supposed to, I mean, everybody was supposed to pour there that day. But yeah, our grand opening was going to be at
the first. The first time anybody was going to taste our beer was going to be at Spring Brew.
Yeah.
And we were so looking forward to that. So as everybody
so
was.
Yeah, so were we, man, because that's a...
Yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah, you boys are hurting over here. So, Invito, you've been on Dr. Homebrew a couple of times, I think, too.
I thought,
not Dr. Homebrew, the regular, me and Sager did the Turbid Mash two-part on the Monday, the Sunday session or Monday session. Like
you've been on.
I think I did Dr. Homebrew once on the Australian Sparkling Ale talk when I got to the metal.
I did
Dr. Homebrew.
Yeah.
And then, me and Matt did our Turbid Mash talk for you guys, which was awesome.
Yeah, that was really fun. So how do you convince, pretend that Brandon and Jessica aren't in the room. How do you convince them to pay you to do something you've never done before?
Well, okay, I'll let him answer that question.
The key is you don't offer to pay them.
Yes.
Perfect.
Yeah.
That's the craft.
So luckily, I'm in a position where I could work for free. And want to brew and have brewed commercially with friends doing pro-ams and even volunteering for weeks at breweries for a couple years now. So I'm working towards that, but this allowed me to be in a good position to work sweat equity. So
and it worked out because obviously I've been drinking his beer for years now, so I know he's got the quality there.
Yeah.
And this is something he wants to do and he wants to be a part of, and I'm like, he believes in us, and I'm super stoked on it because I fully believe in what he does. So it worked out really well that he's capable of putting in that time to be a part of it and feed into it, and just make it bigger than what we were planning on it to be,
Sure.
He's able to get in and be a part of that. So it's really worked out well.
All I heard was Vito is really a rich guy that doesn't need to work.
Not rich by any means. Smart with my money. Rich in life and value. So I don't live with outside my means. So I know what I need, and I can make that.
He's a good guy with a budget, it sounds like. Or he has a lot of Bitcoin. I can't tell which is.
I smell Bitcoin.
Yeah, I made my money in Ripple. Short-lived. Anyway. Well, look, let's take a break because I really do want to open one of your beers. So what should I drink first?
I was thinking about that because I know I gave you at least five or six beers. So we won't get to all of them, but either the American Light Lager or the Australian Sparkling Ale. I'm leaning towards the Australian Sparkling Ale only because that's what I want to go drink right now. What's up?
What's it called?
Simon's Galaxy.
Simon's Galaxy. Let's start there.
Simon's Galaxy.
Is that after Peter?
That's the one I do with Peter. Yeah, Simon's.
Nice. Okay. I'm going to go get that. Sully, sorry, brother. But
Well, you did offer me to come out and get the beers today, but I couldn't get out to Nevada. I was stuck here where you live. I had to.
Yeah.
Other side of the tunnel.
I just really wanted you to deliver a bunch of beer to me, too.
Yeah, that was the plan, wasn't it?
Yeah, basically. All right, let's take a quick break, everybody. This is the session. Hang on. We'll be right back. All right, welcome back, everybody. Thanks for sticking around. We're here with the folks from Imperiale Beer Project out in beautiful Brentwood, California. And, the first time I ever heard of a Brentwood, it was, of course, the Brentwood in L.A. And I, for the longest time, whenever someone would say, oh, yeah, we got that Brentwood corn, or we're going to go to Brentwood to pick cherries, I'm like, why the fuck are you going to L.A. to pick cherries? I don't understand. What's going on?
You know what's funny? I used to live in Brentwood. I lived in Brentwood, and I thought, when I heard Brentwood corn, I was like, there's no fields in Brentwood. What's going on here?
That made it very interesting to open up the cafe when we first started doing research. We had no idea there was another Brentwood, so we were looking up a bunch of information, and nothing was really adding up, and then we finally realized that California does have two Brentwoods, and things got a little bit easier.
We get marketing people reaching out to us all the time.
Oh, yeah. LA real estate people.
Trying to get us to, run ads.
We got a proposition for you. Let's do this.
Yeah, right.
Now, Brentwood's famous for something else down in Southern California, and it's not beer, and it's not corn, it's OJ.
Right. So, this beer that I am personally drinking myself, Sully, it's called Simon's Galaxy.
I love that name.
That's what I'm drinking too.
Nice. What can you tell me about this guy? You said it's an Australian sparkling ale.
I think let's start with, the name, because... So Peter Simons I did a remote collaboration with, and I describe him as the tasty of Australia, which is the easiest way for me to just, for people in our little circles to get. So, but yeah, he's a beer historian. So, and I met him at, was it 2017, the National Homebrewers Convention, where I won a medal for Australian Sparkling Ale. It was the first time that that style had medaled in the, because it only got added in the 2015 guidelines. Anyways, and that, so I guess that was a, that's a good thing. I was, you know, familiar with the style from studying. I became certified, I think it was 2015, 2016, BJCP certified. And so I was familiar with the style and I just wanted to brew something crazy and got a medal for it. So that was cool. But then, yeah, Peter doing the collab with him, it was fun. You know, we got together, I shared my recipe with him and I think I shared it on Dr. Homebrew, like we were talking about earlier.
Yeah.
You know, and he's like, well, Vito, that's not an Australian sparkling ale. It was more of like a pale ale, with, Southern Hemisphere hops with Galaxy. And I used some Dr. Rudy in that one too.
Okay.
Which I think used to be called Super Alpha, anyways, whatever. So this one, we got together, we kind of formulated, he dialed me back more to an Australian sparkling ale, but we did talk about, you know, making it, because there's actually like two versions of an Australian, there's the Australian sparkling, the classic one, and then there's more of the Australian pale ale, which this is more like that. This has a little bit of wheat in it. A good like maltier base malt, you know, so not your like 2 SRM RAR, more something like, you know, a little 5-6 SRM, you know, something a little more malt balance, but still very pale. You know, I mean, it's a pale malt, but a little bit of malt is what is supposed to be in the classic example. So in this one, I used Viking Extra Pale, which is about, yeah, I think it was like 3 SRM. So kind of in between there, then a little bit of wheat malt. And then the other key thing for this style is the Burton yeast. The Burton yeast gives it the, you know, those esters. And then also a little higher than normal sulfite level in the water profile. And then I'll just finish, you know, with a ton of Galaxy hops. You know, this was an expensive beer because Galaxy is not cheap out here for us. So just a lot of Galaxy. It was 2.5 pounds per barrel, which for me is an aggressive dry hop for a pale ale, but you know, I think it comes through. I get that melon, you know, the pear. Yeah, there's just some great aromas, and I think it's 4.6%. Good drinking. You know, I can drink this. This is often my shift beer. So that's kind of the rundown on this Australian sparkling.
Have you sent any to Peter?
I did not. We did send some to GABF. So we put it in that. Yeah, I haven't sent any to Peter. I guess I should. We talked about it. We joked about it. Yeah. Well, you're making me feel guilty now, JP. Yeah,
no, I didn't really think about it.
Yeah.
That's funny. I don't sit here. I don't know how to do that. I just make it.
That's right.
So that's a good point.
Well, I'm just curious to get his take on it, especially because he helped you with the recipe and he is sort of the, you know, expert on Australian beers in general, right? So
yeah,
doing the same thing.
Oh, okay, yeah, that's a great point. Yes, thank you.
Yeah.
He brewed the exact same recipe that we did together, so he was able to taste. Because we did a Doze talk on this, and so we tasted them together side by side. It was his version, obviously, so it was a little different.
Yeah,
but because he couldn't get the Viking malt, but he got some local malt that was, you know, pretty close to the. You know, the friability, the moisture, the protein levels and all that of the malts, you know, is close enough to what we're using. So he did, you know, taste, and that's where we went off on that. You know, this is a sparkling, you know, but not necessarily the traditional, you know, version of it. So
okay.
A little more, but, you know, super quaffable, I think is what, you know, his term for it was.
So, I mean, it sounds like you're sort of, you're trying to take the style and soup it up a little bit for,
like American
craft palates, I guess.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Because you can call it Australian sparkling all day long. That doesn't mean anyone's going to buy it.
Yeah.
If it doesn't taste like something interesting, you know, it's just going to be, it is what it is, right?
We have one big thing going for the beer, though, that definitely helps sell it real quick. It's slightly hazy.
So, you got to know your market, especially out here, man, right?
So I just ask people if they really like hops, and if they say yes, I do, then I tell them you have to try this because it's 100% Galaxy and like an amazing showcase of what they taste like in beer. And that usually does the trick. And then once somebody does it, they're like, oh yeah, I love it.
And did you like ever go in a little deeper with them and be like, well, okay, this is called Australian sparkling ale. And, you know, I don't know.
I started out like it's our Australian sparkling ale, but if you like hops, then blah, 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 and give them a little bit more idea of what to expect from it. Because most people, you know, they'll read red, sour, Australian sparkling ale. Oh, IPA.
Oh, yeah.
So you have to like, go, like, yes, it says this, but it's also like a very good showcase of hops. And if your favorite beer is IPA, then that means you like hops.
Yeah, basically.
Do you describe it as being hazy at all in the description?
No, okay.
This beer is very good.
That's my last resort.
This is like I'm going to sell, just call it a hazy.
Yeah.
Well, it is hazy.
It is hazy. Yeah, right.
It does have a very solid malt character to it, but not overly, I wouldn't even call it. It's very, very dry, very, very carbonated.
Yeah, it was 10.06. Super dry, yeah. Which what I love about this beer and you know, IPA is kind of like, I just love dry beer. I guess that's where I'm going.
Okay. Yeah.
What's the ABV on it?
4.6.
Oh, wow. That's awesome. That's in my wheelhouse. I should have drove out again.
Sure.
Well, exactly. I like beer and I like to drink beer. I don't like to get drunk. I don't even, you know.
That's exactly.
And JP, you can relate to this too. And I think Sully, you're a family man. We all got kids. Like, we can't just be drunk, you
know? Well, you can. No. You just got to make sure they're in bed. No, I'm kidding. I'm the same way. I mean, look, I'm you know, a lot older than everybody here. Here we go. It's story time. And I just kind of let up a little bit. You have to let up, but, no, you're right. But I'm also, up for having an occasional, you know, few beers once in a while and yucking it up.
Yeah. Well, about balance.
I like a high ABV beer. I just, you know, little sips, you know,
Yeah.
So definitely, I guess I don't come off. I don't drink as much as I come off. I drink probably.
Yeah, that's true. Everybody assumes that working in the industry, you drink a crazy amount.
No, yeah. You can't do that.
You're all there.
I'm looking for a pale ale.
Yeah, maybe early on I was that way when I first started because it was all new and I came from an office world, you know, where I worked in an office every day. And then I was like, oh my God, I'm a brewer and I get to, and people like want to talk to you, you know, it's like, and then I got really into it. And then I was like, oh, right, well, got to take it easy.
What effect it has since people aren't coming to visit you right at the brewery, because we're all in lockdown, we're trying to avoid everybody. But there's, I think, that social aspect that is missing or at least cut back a lot. So like if I came over there, we would definitely be having a beer.
Yeah.
It's at 3 o'clock, maybe it's at 11 o'clock in the morning, like who knows, right? So I wonder if that sort of cuts into brewer's time or how much the social aspect of when you're on the shift, you have to have a beer with your guest. You know what I mean?
So yeah, you want a low ABV beer in those times.
Yeah.
We don't have as many people, so there's not the opportunity to take those walks through the restaurant side of it and like say what's up and sit down for a minute.
Even if I've had a couple those members come out or we've done some collabs and if they want to have a drink, a big drink, but yeah, I'm looking for like a little half pour of something like this, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. What did you say this malt was?
This is Viking Extra Pale Malt.
Okay. Viking Extra Pale Malt. Wow.
I've never played with that malt before.
Which is a cool malt. It's got a backstory too. So Morbier started working with Viking to design this malt because they wanted something that was more, their pale malt was more on that, you know, 5-6 SRM, a little more malty. They wanted something more like raw, like a raw type malt. So yeah, it's got a cool backstory on Viking and the Morbier tie-in.
Nice. Very good. Yeah, this is a great flavor. Great grainy flavor, but almost, you know, but like sort of the darker edge of like a biscuity, bready.
Yeah.
Since maybe a little bit of wheat kind of thing going on.
There's wheat in here.
Okay, that's what I was going to say. Is it just the bike? So there is a little bit of
wheat. It's 20%, 20% wheat and 80%. There's a little bit of cara body in there too, like you know, 2%. And then the rest is all like the extra pale.
Okay. What about your hopping schedule on this?
A hop schedule on this one. So there was a little bit of first wort hop, which I like to do, especially on these style of beers, just helps keep the hop breakdown with the oil, the hop oil in there. I just really like that process. And I like the bitterness that it gives. It's kind of this, you know, earthy, deep bitterness that I don't know. I enjoy. Anyway, so there's a first word hop and then all knockout hops. The rest, they're all knockout. So that's it.
Yeah, it's interesting you mentioned first word hopping because I'm editing all the Brew Strong shows right now. So Jamil and John Palmer are really sort of spinning everything back up. They're like 6 months behind or whatever. So if you're a Brew Strong fan, it's coming. We're drip feeding it out. But Palmer's been missing. He had an issue with the family. And so Jamil had on Scott Janisch. Have you ever heard Scott Janisch?
Yeah, I read the IPA book. Yeah,
there you go. Yeah, and so he did a show. They did a show on hop survivables, and he talks about first wort hopping, adding some of that. There is a flavor. There is a thing that you don't get further on down the line that sort of amplifies everything else that you do get further down the line. If that makes any sense, so it does help sort of bring a roundness and more fullness to a hop forward beer like this.
I mean, yeah. we've done that before, but I mean, I don't know if we did it in the abundance that was necessary to sort of achieve that flavor. I mean, how much are you adding when you're doing first word hop?
Not much. I mean, considering, but the nice thing is there's only so much utilization you can get, right? At some point you get 100% utilization and it doesn't matter. I am getting a lot of BUs. I usually try and keep it, let's see, of the total BUs, I would say I keep it under 20% probably of the total, 20 to 30%. For me, okay, so I'm producing 7 barrels. So it's, you know, a pound is a lot, you know, that's like a big first word hop for me. For you, that's like, you know, not even.
Wait, slow down. I have a 12 barrel system, so I know exactly what you're talking about. So settle down. Don't yell at me. Just to...
Sorry.
I'm kidding. Yeah, so I mean, so you're adding like a pound at the beginning, and
half a pound, right around there.
Would be okay,
big first word hop, yeah, for me.
Got it. And then you're not adding anything until the end, knockout or something like that. Okay, and then what's the volume there?
That on this one, I want to say it was about 4 pounds, 3 to 4 pounds of Galaxy All In Knockout. I'll start whirlpooling it, try and, you know, drop 210, 208, and then I'll add the hops. I'm not going back through my heat exchanger and trying to drop it down, do anything, you know.
That can be messy. And then what are you dry hopping? How much, you said 3 pounds?
The dry hop on this was 2.5 pounds per barrel.
2.5. Where did you get your Galaxy? I can't get Galaxy to save my life. And was it like $1,000 a pound?
$25 a pound.
That's good.
Every once in a while, you'll see it out there on the Lublin Exchange or actually, and hopefully we'll get into this later, talking about a lot of my hops I've got through other breweries in the area. And that's, I'd really like to thank them, and that, and I really even to other breweries, like that's the network is so, you know, joining the guilds, talking to other breweries,
and seeing all
being friends, especially right now.
I completely agree with that. I mean, like it that even happened to me today. I mean, this is at the production brewery, so it's a lot of hops. I mean, we needed 7 boxes of Centennial, and we weren't getting our delivery until this week. So I just went out there, like reached out to Jeremy Marshall up at Lagunitas, and he was like, got it, no problem at all. And I said, doesn't this remind you of the early days when we were like doing this? Like you needed like oxygen, like, you know, oxygen tank, or you needed like, you know, malt or hops or some sort of technology, maybe borrow somebody's filter if you were filtering back then. And like, it's awesome when it happens. It's just like, it's, you know, everybody, and that's what's great about the guild, honestly. Everybody just, you need something, there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's made so many friends outside of the guild, but then now that we are a part of the guild, it's just opened it up, especially
when
people are just trying to sell off inventory that they're not going to use.
Yeah.
It's a huge thing for a place like us in our position to have access to like super like primo stuff.
Well, guys, if anybody out there, if you guys need Centennial Cascade or Columbus, I'm your guy.
I love your classic C box.
Like 5, someone's gonna hit you up on that. So exactly.
I'll be like weighing out like 1 pound bags, sending them out to people. Like, why did I make that announcement?
that's a really, like, cool thing too. Like the hops, and I know a lot of brewers and homebrewers as well. There's so many different, like, not all Mosaic is the same, right? Like when you're buying the amount that Sully's buying or some of these other, they get lot selection. which allows you to kind of tailor your, you know, I get a ton of melon from this one, I want that one. I get onion and garlic from this, I don't want that one. So to me, having those, I don't have the buying power to get that, but having the connections to talk to people that are doing that to get those hops is very valuable, you know, and that's
it's awesome when you can do it. I mean, it's sometimes we're able to do it, sometimes we're not. Like great example, Centennial. Centennial is actually one of my favorite hops, and you know, it's old school hop. It's multi versatile. You know, my Centennial that I go to is something that has more of a top note citrus. You know, more like a, and not so dank. Some people love dank. That's what's so funny about, I mean, you probably heard this about hop selection, is that it's like, I always think it'd be funny to be like a hop salesman and be in the room when brewers come in to do their hop selection up at Yakima, because they're like, I fucking hate these hops. And the next brewer's coming, like, these are amazing. It's like, it's like one brewer's gold is another brewer's shit. So it's like, you know, everybody's looking for something different, like you said.
Imagine if you're doing group selection and you've got two people that are divided, like you're with a couple other breweries and you're divided on that, like trying to be like, I want that one, I want that one.
Well, when you're the boss, you can just say, we're gonna get this.
The hops, big part of what we're trying to do is source good hops, you know, from however we can, and that's through the community.
I imagine that community spirit is sort of even more active now. Because like you were saying, Brandon, you know, people need to get rid of stuff. You know, your production level's down. I mean, your guys' production level is higher than it was before you opened, obviously, right? Because you're brand new. But, you know, there's a lot of breweries who maybe are sitting on inventory who do want to help other people out. And that's really great.
Yeah.
What else should I open with me by myself here alone?
Oh, man. Okay. Let's see. American Light Lager I would do next.
American Light Lager. All right. What's it called, brother?
Delta Good. Delta Good. That's a great name. You guys have good names.
Okay.
I have Hef Bezos. Have Strap Across Town, Compa, and a boy and a dog.
Yeah, for sure. Do the Hef Bezos. Let's do Hef Bezos, because that would lead into something I'd love to talk about.
That's going
to
be a good transition for your palate.
Yeah, a good transition for the palate. And another low ABV beer. And the local agriculture.
Local fruit, because we have so much agriculture out here. We're super stoked to like take that in and do something with it.
Incorporate it all,
Whether it be in the kitchen or in the beer.
Okay. All right. You know what, actually? So I love this label. Because on the side, it looks like a little Amazon cart. Obviously, Hef Bezos is a tribute to Mark Zuckerberg from Facebook. and then on the back, there's all the hops. And here, I'll put it to the camera. I don't know if it'll translate well, but it's kind of cute. You got all the hops checked, and it's nice. Tell me about this guy.
All right. So, how this beer came about, usually Brandon and myself will start riffing on what kind of beers we need to brew. And he wanted to do a fruited wheat ale, or like a half, because he had a cool name, Hef Bezos. So the idea was there before the beer. And I'm like, I'm not a big fan of hef yeast, that clove and banana. So I'm like, well, you know, I don't want to do that. So it'll be an American wheat. And I'm like, I really want to play with, I've done it in the homebrew scale, but I hadn't done any commercial Quebec beers. So I want to do a Quebec beer. So there's the Voss Quebec yeast, or that's redundant, but Voss Quebec there. For the yeast, that was part of the idea. And then the next one was we wanted to use fresh agriculture. And this is, we've done this, I think, three times now.
Yeah.
We're using fresh. And that was what was really cool that I was looking forward to. You know, out here is a huge agriculture community. And in my mind, when we started this, and we're right on the street where the farmer's market is.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I'm going to go walk through the farmer's market and pick up 100, 200 pounds of this. It's going to be like so rad. And being able to not walking out in the farmer's market, we've used connections
we'll
that Brandon has
and
local farms.
Because we've worked with farms and vendors and stuff out here before from the bar before. So it's, we've already kind of like, we know
who, he's got the connection.
We know who to work with. So it's just figuring out what fruit's going to work well for the recipe or something like that.
So he called up the farm and they said, well, melons are in season. So it's like, boom, okay, we got melon. We know the fruit.
Three nuns.
Did you say melon? I'm sorry, what?
No. Sorry.
Yeah. Whoa.
I want to get a season to come after you now.
You already played that game with one big beer.
Yeah, send the cease and desist.
So the melon came together. And then for me, once I knew melon, El Dorado, I get a lot of melon from. So I was like, boom, El Dorado, double down on the melon. And that was kind of the idea for this beer. So it's Quebec. So it's fermented at 95 degrees. Without any fruit in there, it's already throwing pineapple and mango flavors. And then when we did 120 pounds of fruit, it was 90 pounds of honeydew, 30 pounds of cantaloupe, and then 11 pounds of El Dorado, which is about a pound and a half per barrel of El Dorado. And then, you know, slicing that up. So that's, you know, working with the natural fruit, it's fun, but it's a pain in the ass because you're cutting it all day. You're working on it. You got to sanitize. You know, you're trying to keep your oxygen out. You know, these challenges. But it's super fun. And when you create a beer like that, and then, you know, people enjoy it, and it's the local fruit. To me, that's just super amazing. Yeah. So that's
which yeast did you use?
The Voss.
The Voss. Okay, the Voss. Okay.
So for me, what I did was I knocked out at 80 because I'm still a crazy about hot side aeration. So I brought it down to that, and then aerated the wort, obviously, and then let it free rise back up to 95. I actually set the temp at 98, but it never got past 95. It got up to 94, 95, and then it was done within, 24 or 36 hours.
Isn't that wild what you just said, though? I mean, I set it to 98. It never got to 98, but it got to 95. I mean, it's just like when you know.
Well, the crazy thing is,
what's going on?
Barley esters that we all love, but then no fusel alcohol. That's what's great about Quebec yeast, is no fusel. Because usually, if you did an ale yeast at that temperature, oh god, it would just taste like
mess.
You know, so it's that's what's crazy to me about Quebec. Yeah,
it was funny seeing the fermenters, all of them sweating, and then the one is not, and you go up and feel it, and it's like super warm to the touch.
That's got to freak you out at some point. Like, you know, well, like you're saying, you know, like you're still hot side aeration guy, which is very home brewery, right?
Yeah. So
it is sort of like runs counter to everything we've ever learned about fermentation, where it's like, this is a body temperature. This is fermenting at almost body temperature.
Yeah.
You kind of just have to, talk yourself out of lowering it and be like, no, I screwed up. I got to lower it. I got to do it normally. And then.
So I did some previous experiments with the yeast that did, not Voss, it was a Hortonol, for writing an article for More Beer, and did some side-by-sides. And the lower fermentation temperature does not, I mean, it's not even neutral clean. It's like, you know, not that good, but the higher temp throws these beautiful esters. And so I knew kind of going into it, like, oh, you got to go high with this yeast. That's just how you work with that strain. It is freaking wild though. Cause it's like, before we discovered that, which was in my life of home brewing, you know, you'd never ferment anything like, well, you do like kettle set lacto and stuff like that up at 100 degrees, no ale yeast.
I mean, but even then saisons are, you know, 80s. Well, like you said, it's a mix, but this is not, I wouldn't say this is clean as not like in a contamination point of view, like an estuary thing. There is, I want to say like almost an earthy or like a darker weedy kind of thing, but it's definitely not a hef yeast. It's definitely not an ale yeast. You know what I mean? As you would know it today. So there are some flavors that kick off. Do they change when you adjust the fermentation temperature? I would imagine.
Definitely. So the lower one to me is lower. You know, I did that one at 72, I think 73, with a 1 degree differential. So, you know, floating around there, whatever. Mm-hmm. It was not spectacular. It was more neutral. It was cleaner than this. You know, but it didn't have those esters.
You need that temp to get the esters.
Yeah, it didn't have. It was, you know, I would never recommend that yeast at that temperature. It's like, use a Saison yeast or use a New England yeast that's going to throw those fruit characters at 72 and be a hell of a lot cleaner, or I mean, just like a better taste. I don't know. But so for me, Quebec shines in the 90s, I guess is what I'm saying.
Yeah. I really like this. I think number one, you should probably sour some of this. This, to me, this sort of screams out like being like wanting to be soured.
Oh yeah. Yeah. We're starting a sour program soon. We're getting a fooder.
Oh, no.
So, yeah, I started doing some sour. I love like sours for sure. So I'm looking forward to that.
I think when we first met, he always talked about he loved doing the Solaris stuff. So
yeah.
This opportunity to get a fooder came up. It was like, well, shit, we have so much fruit. We wanted to do the Solaris thing and just do different fruit each season, whatever was good.
The local fruit.
So I was like, fuck, that's perfect. Like, that's the direction we need to go.
Well, yeah, I mean, hit up all the cherry, the you pick cherry places or whatever. There's a ton of that shit out here.
I got one.
I think also this needs some rum in it. Like, this is a
Jesus
for one of those. Like,
you guys have to understand. Like, JP is a total like tropical drink fan. So
what
he's like, everything should have rum in it. His rum should be in his scrambled eggs.
You have to have the tiki tincture too. Cool, we'll do that one next. And that's more of a rum drink. It's more of a grog drink, you know. Tiki terms, yeah.
We could do that. Yeah, I like this. That's a really good. It's a good take on it.
Sounds good.
I appreciate you guys are really doing the local thing, and like you're saying, you know, we're in such a big agriculture area. I mean, basically, Oakley and Brentwood are on old farms that got broken up in the city. Right? So, we're here. Yeah, we're doing
not ready, but one of the cool ones that we just did recently is we went and picked Sauv Blanc grapes.
Yeah.
So we pressed the Sauv Blanc juice here. I sulfited it, racked it into a carboy, and then racked it again. So we're going to add that juice, that 22 bricks juice, back to this IPA that we got, Nelson IPA. We're going to dry hop that today and then add it. I think it's at 10.07, but it'll get it back up to like 10.08. So it'll still be dry as hell, but it'll be back sweetened with like local softball grapes.
Yeah.
So super stoked.
Drove out into the random people's property. We saw some white grapes and we just started cutting them.
Jesus.
That wasn't the case. The vendor I'm friends with, she gave me directions, but it was like I had to write the directions down on the back of a small piece of paper, and it was, make a left here, a right here, look for the almond field, a quarter mile up, turn left on the canal road, follow that to the end, turn right. You'll see a white grape field, and that's it. So we just drove. There was nobody there to tell us we were at the right spot, but fuck, we found grapes, and we cut them out. So.
The next year, someone's like, I don't know, fuck, grapes left.
The son is a regular of ours. He works with the family, obviously, and he follows us on social media. And when I was talking to him, I was like, I think I went to your guys' field. I wasn't sure. He's like, oh, the pictures look like it, but, you know, nobody said anything, so who cares?
Yeah, that wasn't our field.
Yeah. It's one thing that not a lot of people know about this area. There's a lot of wine, a lot of vineyards.
Oh, man, have you been to Livermore lately?
Yeah.
Yes, and it's either for a while there, it was just all housing, like all these townhomes, and then suddenly that stopped, and now it's all vineyards on the hills and shit.
I feel like, it was one day I just drove through there, and I went through there every week to go pick up Humble C and Alvarado Street, and I feel like it was just one day, it was like everything was green, and there was like vines going, what the hell?
It's
awesome.
It's beautiful, and like it's cool for the area.
Yeah, it is neat, you know. It's like, I'm from Livermore, I grew up in the area, and it's like, driving through that area now, the Dublin, Pleasanton, it's completely
especially there, man, all up the mountains there.
The whole side of the foothills. Yeah, and I feel like an old head, man, where it's like, I remember when this was nothing but fields. And I caught myself telling my wife that, like, last year we're driving through the back way to, you know, get whatever. And I'm like, man, I really remember that all of this was
all of the houses were there.
Yeah, and I had to stop myself. I'm like, Jesus, I turned into my fucking dad, because he used to tell me that shit. Where he's like, well, I remember, you know, all these vineyards here, you know, there were olive trees, and they got all ripped out, and they put vineyards in. And I used to go jackrabbit hunting with your girl. I'm like, I don't fucking care, dude. I'm 8. I just want to go home and eat pizza. Like, I don't give a shit. And now I'm telling the same story, and Terrence probably saying the same thing that I was saying to my dad.
And your daughter's like, what is he, really?
Yeah. Like, well, at that point, she was floating and gaga goo goo. I don't know. All right, let's take a quick break. Here are the beers. Well, we'll do the beers later. Let's take a break. We're going to gather our thoughts. We're going to drink more beer. And then I want to talk to you guys about the transition from, how do you open in a pandemic? To me, that's like,
yes, I want to hear that too.
One of the more rare stories
as a business owner.
Yeah, people are surviving the pandemic. They weren't even open when it started. So to me, that's super interesting. So we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to be right back with the folks from Imperiale Beer Project. Hang on, this is the session. We'll be right back. All right, welcome back, everybody. Thanks for hanging on. We have the folks from Imperiale Beer Project out in beautiful Brentwood, California, here with us, as well as our good, close, personal friend, Sully O'Shaughnessy.
Hey, glad to be here. This is awesome. I'm enjoying myself.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it. You sound great for the little microphone, man.
Do I? It's my Yeti. It's check this out. I can only get the gold one, so it's like a trophy. So
you and Rush Limbaugh, man. You have a gold microphone.
Brewcasting in excellence.
Okay, I have two beers in front of me. One is a Strat Across Town, which is a wet hop IPA. And we were talking during the break. I wanted to try this one because I like wet hop beers. And you don't really
Wow.
a lot anymore. Yeah, you really don't. But I don't.
Wet hop beers.
What's that? Right.
You don't like IPAs, but you like wet hop beers?
Yep, that's me, dude.
I don't understand it either.
My favorite beer basically ever is, well, my top five is Celebration.
Celebration.
Which is mostly wet hop beer, I found out. It's not all wet hop, but it's mostly wet hop beer.
Is it, though? Is it, though?
Yeah.
I look forward to
No. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. It's not wet hop. I apologize. I'm crossing my streams. However, it is an IPA. And when it's celebration season, that's all I'm drinking is celebration. So anyway, Strat Across Town, a wet hop IPA. Please tell me about this beer.
Please.
Start with the hop journey, I think, because that's kind of cool. My friend Lester from Bear Bottle and Justin from Ghost Town drove up and got the wet hops from Strata, from Indie Independent Hops, and brought them down, you know, within 24 hours of picking. So they drove up, so they were there that morning. They pick at nighttime. You know, they're there that morning, and then they're driving back the next day. I had already planned out my beer because I'd been talking to them for a while. Like, okay, so I wanted to use them on the cold side. A lot of people use them in the kettle. In the mash even, and I did use some of the mash in another beer, but for this beer in particular, I just wanted to do it all on the cold side, and not like dry hopping with it, but after you've reached terminal and you've chilled the beer down a little, recirculating like a torpedo, like that type of. So I timed the beer so I was at that point to do a basically like a torpedo.
We packed in our hop back and then just circulated it for like what.
36 hours about that, on 30 pounds. I had enough to probably do another charge. And after, you know, cleaning up the first one, I was just like, ah, hell with it. I'm not going to do a second charge. And then tasting the finished beer, I'm actually happy I did not do a second charge because it got all that wet hop, you know, taste and aroma that I was looking for. So I was happy with that decision, I guess, after the fact.
So what made you try the cold.
I was talking through with other local brewers about how they process them, and you know, I'm not a huge fan of wet hop beers, and I think a lot of those were, you know, processed on the kettle side. So maybe I was like, hey, this might be a different way to extract some of that without getting all these, like, you know, oil. Getting some alpha amortization on them.
That deep resin.
That deep resin. Like,
yeah.
Freshness out into the beer. I don't know. Yeah, so that was my theory or thought process.
Yeah, I mean, you are, you know, essentially, you know, blanching or you're almost cooking the wet hops. It feels like that's what it always smells like to me whenever, you know,
it's vegetable a little.
Vegetative.
Yeah, it's like you're sort of boiling these things that aren't processed yet, you know, drying is a process. Sorry, hippies, but you're drinking processed beers.
Whoa.
I don't know.
Get off my lawn.
I have some IPA. I want to fight everybody. That's why I need my. No, but this is very good because it doesn't have those sort of processed flavors like you were talking about trying to avoid. It is, it's not resinous. It's not harsh. You know, sometimes wet hop beers can sort of be so packed that there is that sort of like hop oil, lupulin scraping effect. This doesn't have that. It does have the flavor of hops, of wet hops, and it's a little darker. A little more earthy, I think, than just like a dried hop or a pellet or whatever. But
sure,
it's very different and unique. I really like it.
Oh man, cheers! That's awesome. Thank you. Yeah, I'm really stoked on it. And then I guess something else that's special about this beer: the grist is This one was Pilsner malt, Vienna malt, and a little bit of Munich. So that's the malt bill. O1 Cal Ale yeast. But then the thing that's special about this is we did this collab for the one-year anniversary for the bar
that we used to own.
Yeah.
So this is his anniversary beer. So he wasn't even thinking about it. He's just like, you know, 1 year into owning a business, never owned a business before, and he's dealing with all this stuff and trying to adapt right now. He didn't, like, do anything for his 1 year, and I had to remind him because I was thinking, like, oh, we started construction a year ago. Like, and this, who'd have thought where we are right now?
Yeah.
I was like, hey, man, like, you going to do anything? You want to make a beer or something? And I knew he's, like, he's a little bit older than me. He's, like, old-style beer drinker.
Where, he
like,
was a dozen member.
Yeah, he was.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, really? Damn.
He likes, like, big IPAs. Like, he's
a
big beer fan. Like, when those were, like, the beer you chase, those big IPAs.
Yeah.
So you're like, oh, we're doing a wet hop beer. It'd be perfect. So we let him kind of, like, chime in on that. He came over, helped out. You know?
Okay, so that's why it's, like, 7.3%? Because this asshole... No, it has a very good flavor. I do like the Munich comes through, and I think it sort of, I don't know, it balances out a little bit, you know, or maybe it even enhances some of those subdued flavors that you get from wet hops. You know, part of the, it just shouldn't be 100% wet hop with like a single malt or whatever, you know what I mean? It's, you want to showcase, but you also want to balance it out too. And I think you did a pretty good job with that. Yeah.
That's been my approach to a lot of these beers. You know, I mean, people, the market likes to punch you in the face, but balances.
Yeah,
you know,
that's one thing I love about him, that everything he makes is like it's beer for drinking. You know, it's good.
It is, man. So
we should try and push more, and he'll no. He'll set it down. Say, this is what the recipe demands.
Sully, I chose this glass just for you, by the way.
Oh, Bitter American! I love that beer. Yeah,
there's Ham. Hello, Ham.
Bring it back, Sully.
We did bring it back. It's not Bitter American. It's Down to Earth, which is just a little adjustment of Bitter American. Yeah. Just it's a hop change, essentially. But that beer is back. Down to Earth is back. So
okay,
it's in a variety pack. That's my plug. That's the only.
I had Down to Earth. Down to Earth's amazing. I do like that one. I didn't know that.
Yeah,
Bitter
American. Yeah, Bitter American, baby.
It's a good time to be a Bitter American. Actually,
Lower the Boom or my 21A. Like diehard
beers,
I love that.
Monk's Blood.
That's Monk's Blood and Lower
the Boom. Oh yeah, Monk's Blood is killer, man.
Yeah, I should send some to you then. We call Lower the Boom Vicodin in a can.
Yeah. It was so intriguing in the small cans when I first saw it. It's like a bunch of beer, whatever it is.
Yeah. It's dangerous.
Okay, so let me talk to you guys about opening up during a pandemic. Okay, so you said
and you know what? Those words have never been strung together before in the history of time, probably. Maybe back in the early 1900s, whatever.
Yeah, number one, it implies that we're done, that we're over with it, which we're not, although a lot of people think we are. So you started construction, you said, in August?
August last year, so about a year ago. We started construction. We're in a brand new building. It was just a lot before they started framing it up. We got in while they had like started that. And then, last August we broke ground, had to dig everything up, you know, do in-ground plumbing, all that stuff.
Okay.
Frame up walls, yada, yada, yada. But we finished everything up, you know, lots of long nights, him coming after work.
Sure.
You know, do a lot of stuff ourselves just because got to be cost effective.
That's what we did.
We finance everything ourselves, you know, we don't have backers or anything. So it's a lot of labor into it, which I think kind of helped me lure him to the sweat equity thing because he saw me doing it.
Super handy now.
Yeah, but we finished up, and I was calling for our final inspections the day shelter in place happened. And in the morning,
Jesus,
I got confirmations from inspectors from health department, fire department, the officers that need to come look, the city planning department, everybody. Yep, we'll be there, you know, 2 days out, 1 day out, blah, blah, blah. And then later that afternoon, canceling all inspections indefinitely, yada, yada, yada. You know, had some panic attacks and some anxiety attacks.
Yeah, I remember some of those conversations.
It's been real fun at home.
Yeah, we finished out March in a real positive note.
During that time, you were like, I remember you saying, like, I'm prepared to get arrested.
Yeah.
I like that.
They're working us open because we hadn't finished the permitting process. I called the city and everybody, because we're cleared to make beer, and I guess technically we're cleared to sell beer, but they didn't want us to operate out of our establishment, which,
because we didn't get the final walk.
Yeah, because we weren't cleared to occupy. So there's a lot of like gray.
But you can't occupy anyway.
Yeah, there's a lot of gray area in there.
It's super weird that you have clearance to operate, but not to occupy the space. So exactly.
It's like the final walkthrough.
Yeah, you can make beer, but you can't be there to make beer. Is that okay?
That's exactly.
Essentially,
That's what it is.
I think
I would have totally been the same way. I would have been like, let's break the law. Let's see what happens. Because
at this point, it's been
I mean, off the record.
Yeah, off the record.
I mean, I would never do that, but you should.
Are you winking?
I feel like I just like my business partner's going to be like, what are you saying?
So we had the shelter in place right here, what, like March 11 or something like that? Like
17. Yeah.
All right.
And then, by April, once I figured out that like nobody's, initially it was like, okay, is the country going to like, everybody going to hit the pause button? We'll all figure this out, together and make sure everybody's okay.
Yeah.
No.
Of course not.
So it was like, okay, everybody's still debiting the account and we're at the end of the account. We need to get some money coming in. And that's when it was like, fuck it, we're going to just sell as many crawlers as we can out the front door. Let's just start going. Because at that time, we were planning on most of our sales going through the tap room in the form of draft and crawlers and growlers. So we just had a cold room just stuffed full of kegs. And so it was just, a couple hundred crawlers a day for a few weeks. Just kind of pumped.
So did people come out? Were people like, you got the word out and people came out and they like realized what was going on?
We had a good following from our owning the we established out here. We had a brand established.
We have a really
out here.
Great community.
We've got a ton of great supporters who are just like, they like us. They like what we're doing. They like what we bring to the area. And they've been I feel like they've watched us grow from, starting out in 2016 to they knew we sold
they
and
with us.
Everything. And they've been watching us do construction over here because we're on the main road downtown where the farmer's market is. So like they've been waiting for it. And so it was good to like, got to introduce them over time and start getting more people to know what's going on. And then finally it was just like, we just put it out there on Instagram and Facebook. Just like, hey, tomorrow's the day. Our online site's up, start placing your orders, we're selling crawlers. And we just got a really good response, ton of love. And luckily we've been able to pay our bills since then, I want to be bitter about everything just because, we're not doing what we could be doing.
Sure. Yeah, you have to pivot though. You're exactly right though.
But we're also, sorry, somebody asked if we're open.
We're like right in the front window right now.
Oh, you are? You should turn your camera around for a second. It'd be funny to see.
We're really lucky to have the support and be able to pay the bills. There's two sides to it. Everything sucks and it's really, really difficult. But also, like we're still here, which is a lot more than some people can say.
We are still here.
Yeah, I think if we could survive through this.
Exactly. There's so many breweries that I looked up to and I loved it. And I'd see them like closing the doors or venues closing doors.
It's been so disappointing.
Shit, like that really sucks. I never would have guessed that place was in a situation, that.
Yeah, dude, like Slim's closed down.
Right? Oh my God, right?
Like that's
good. What the hell?
I think they were planning to close it, weren't they?
Were they?
I think there was like some.
I'd rather be more outraged about it, personally.
Okay, I heard they didn't want to close.
especially the ones that went out early.
They knew they were on
like
the way
Cleophis, out. Like a week after COVID, they were like full. And I love that place, and I love those guys.
Old Republic, RIP Old Republic. I love them.
Were you guys, have you worked with your landlord? Do you own your building? Did you work with your...
We don't own our building.
But was your landlord like? Was he like, work with you on this, or was
he
it like
the first month? And then after that, it was like business as usual. Which I guess I get. He's got a lot of guys that have helped us out, and he did a lot of work for us to kind of help us along the construction side of it. So like, I get it. You got to keep money in the system.
Yeah.
It's all about cash flow. He's got to pay his guys. I think I haven't pressed it too hard with him because we've been so lucky to get that cash flow coming in and get that support. But I know that if we really asked him, I think he'd do it because he's a local businessman. He owns a lot of property in town. He lives in town.
He wants to see everybody. Do
wait until
well.
We need it, though.
Exactly.
Don't tap it.
Yeah.
We're doing okay.
We're struggling. Yeah. It hasn't been easy, but
if you're gonna
not
on that card,
you should tickle that a little bit. Because you know.
Yeah, have Vito tickle him.
Yeah, tickle them. Tickle them. Definitely tickle them. The owners of building love when you tickle them.
You guys are lucky that you do have a community to back you, especially with no. I mean, you have brand carryover from the bar, but there's no clout, I guess, for the beer side either. Vito, were you making beer? Did you make beer before April, or when was the first time you brewed on that system?
Am I allowed to talk about that? Or
yeah.
Whatever. Nobody knows.
Sounds like you have to now, doesn't
it?
Last week.
We had beer ready for the spring Bruce Fest, which was in March. So you could run the timelines. Yeah. You run the timelines off that.
We started brewing in February, but he'd done a lot of stuff, and he's been really active in the homebrew community.
A lot of brewing
and stuff. So he definitely, there's people that know of Vito or have come across him at festivals, or like, you know, the best part of some of the beer fests is the homebrew booths, seeing what people come up with. Okay. And he always kills it at the booths. He's come across a lot of people through that, I think. So I think it's just been a good partnership, and it's worked out well so far. You know, we're still here. We're still working. So
yeah, that's good. And so
that exactly.
How many beers do you have available right now? I mean, I
get 12 now.
I think we're at 12 right now.
A lot of beer for a place that can't have anybody inside that you're just doing. Yeah. Like, what the?
Here's a cool fact. I think we've done.
We're at 32.
We have 32 beers that we've made. Only two of them have been like rebrews. So we're just doing a ton of different stuff.
That's the case. Yeah.
Yeah. So we brewed 38 batches though so far since we've opened. We've got 32 out there. Only two are redundant. Yeah. Are not redundant, but,
rotating's kind of our thing. We did that at the last place, just making sure we always had something new and fresh and like a really wide varieties of styles on tap. And even though that was a lot, I mean, it was nice at the cafe. We definitely wanted to carry that over. We do that with our food too.
I think we noticed that got a really good response from people. Yeah. And
especially when you're coming in all the time. Like if you're a regular and you have the same, I mean, how many times can you order the same IPA, the same, you know?
And
that's fun for me.
Yeah, we got a good response from it. And I think we saw like the breweries that like really took off. That was kind of what they were doing, is like that alternating variety. Like you could get the same beer every so often, but you had a bunch in there to kind of like keep you interested. Well, to an extent, depending on the style. But
you don't have any regular beers, like any staples that you keep on, any flagships, I guess, or anything like that?
We've New School Kicks. And
yeah, we haven't had anything that stays on.
Nothing. We've just done it twice.
So we have two beers that have stayed on just because they're not as popular of style.
Red Dog.
Red.
The red,
and then our Sweet Stout. We brewed a Sweet Stout at the beginning of summer. Who'd have thunk that it didn't go quickly?
So the cool thing about those, though, and if you talk to brewers, they'll always say this.
I was going to say, all the brewers that have come through, the red's been their favorite. Yeah.
That's so funny. That'd be like,
commercially, they don't do well. Yeah. But
when you guys,
it's cool because it holds down a tap.
Exactly. Yeah. That was kind of the plans. Like, we knew the stuff's not going to move as quickly, but we always want
style.
And so, like, what's going to hold up well? What's going to still be a good representation over time? And we went from there, and it's worked out well. I mean, everything still tastes really good. People still like it. We actually get a lot of compliments on our variety that we have.
Yeah,
it's funny you mentioned a lot of brewers drink the red, because I was looking through the list, because I'm like, look, if you guys are coming out here, I want some extra beer. So it's like the black lager. I got
try that black
lager.
I
love that black lager. Right?
The Delta Good or whatever.
I love black lager.
And then I got that red because people don't make a red ale, and if they do, it's usually 7%, and I'm not trying to do that.
It's overhopped.
5, and I don't want to do it. So if you give me a red ale in the 5 area, which I think yours is 5.3, if I remember correctly.
5.3, yeah. It's 5. Is it 5 exactly?
I'm going to try it every time because I like red ales. I don't know what it is, but
if I go to a brewery and I see like a red ale or a brown ale even.
Yeah. Brown ale, key.
Depending on it. Yeah, and that's how I shop for beers. I go style, and then I go ABV. If those line up, which is rare, then I'm drinking. Then I'm going to have a good time. If not,
that's the cool thing that's been, we do what's popular, right? Hazy IPAs, we're doing all that stuff. But then Brandon, he's like, let's do some stuff that we like, too. Yeah. And keep those on.
What's the point if we can't have
them? Yeah.
And also, it's like, I think it's duty now to, it's the brewer's duty to, like, we dictate, or we can dictate, you know, what
is
popular.
Yeah.
So, like, if everybody's just chasing money and making, you know, hazy beers are really good and I like them. And we make,
I do too, yeah.
We make them, obviously, but like some like just the slushy, crazy, like overfruited bombs that are just waiting to blow up in people's trunks.
Do you get lagers? Any like pilsners or anything like that? Or
We've done.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. Lagers.
Yeah.
We've got two more.
Our first beer we brewed was an Italian pilsner.
That was batch one.
Yeah.
Right on. Contact me in April to come and get some, and I was too scared. I didn't do it.
I know. I sent you that email. Yeah, dude, that beer was killer too. We got to rebrew that.
Yeah, please rebrew that. So actually, that leads me into. What are you guys doing protection-wise for everybody? Like when people are bringing beer people are picking up beer from you, for example, or buying food or whatever, how are you handling that side of thing? Like making sure that everybody stays apart or you know, the kind of COVID protections that we're all taking place. And I'm asking just for me personally, because I'm trying to sort of still wrap my head around this because I'm a big baby about you.
So
you're concerned.
Yeah. And it's definitely not, I'm not trying to like, it's not a gotcha question. It's I'm definitely not asking to go, well, you should be fucking doing this. I'm just curious because we're all supposed to be doing stuff, but you know, you look at some brewery's social media or you see other things from other places and like, they're not doing everything that they can or
that we can't.
I just want to know.
And like the collab, like a lot of the stuff we're not doing because of the pandemic. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes.
Well, because I feel like there are more people out there like me that aren't going out and supporting anybody because I don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
So I just want to talk to you guys about it and see what you guys are doing.
Once you dip out here, the level of concern is much lower for sure.
That's true. Yep.
Sometimes a little too low in our opinion, but just from the start of it, what we've seen happen in our own personal experiences, we did have an employee that got COVID and like we had to close down and like go through all of that. Our level of concern has dropped a little bit just because like now we know that masks fucking work, man. Like,
yeah.
That's my thing.
That's
is
controversial to say for some reason, but masks can
work. She worked at Kaiser. She worked with multiple people that have had COVID and gotten sick from COVID, but she hasn't got it.
And I've been tested.
They wear masks.
We had the whole staff get tested.
Whole staff is tested. We had a sanitization company come through and fog the whole brewery after it. But pretty much we've got our chemical supply company that does all of our soaps and stuff for the kitchen or behind the bar, whatever. They make a bunch of CDC-approved disinfectants and stuff like that. So those are pretty much just replaced all cleaning supplies that we used prior to COVID or we would have used.
Yeah.
So now we just came with disinfectant. So like no matter what, something's getting touched with disinfectant multiple times a day. And of course, we're just mindful of it, you know?
Yeah.
The table's six per person.
Six.
Everything's spaced out, outside.
And just also just communicating with people, making sure that they're comfortable. You know, if we're going to see somebody somewhere, like it's a little weird on the patio and one of the tables might be, you know, a touch less than 6 feet apart from another one. Just make sure like, hey, are you okay with this? And if you're not, we'll try and get you somewhere else. It's really just about making sure that whoever's coming is as comfortable as they need to be. If they don't give a shit about anything, cool. Have at it. Go for it.
Yeah.
I'm wearing a mask. I'm not going to hug you. We'll be all right.
Right. But,
you know, if you're really concerned, you'll see us cleaning everything. We wipe off and sanitize every table in between. We do the door handles and doorway, like, I think twice an hour. Just because we have spikes here of, like, busy and slow. And that's like wipe down stuff is a filler thing for when it's slow. And so anytime it's slow, somebody's like, all right, I'm gonna go wipe shit.
They gotta wear masks inside.
Yeah. And masks all inside. The time. We're real hard with that just because that's of all this, I think some of it has been a little bit of paranoia that took over for people. Masks is the one thing that I think is like key to everybody's safety, regardless of how concerned you are about it, you know?
Yeah. Absolutely. Okay. I think that's good. And then like when you're packaging stuff, like when you're packaging, you know, beers or whatever, I'm sure, do you have a canning line or do you have
people? Oh, no, we don't have a canning line. We have a service come in, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, gloved up, masked up, all that stuff.
Okay.
And
cool.
That's really it, yeah. We do everything we can.
Yeah.
Just try to wash us up.
While you're canning. Can.
I mean, I personally, like, I struggle with it because I'm like, I don't want to get sick in general, but also like, it's a big thing for me, and I just want to keep everybody I know safe. But like, you know, I get the cans. I'm like, oh, okay, so I sprayed them down. I'm like, what about the tops? I don't know. And then start losing my mind about like how everything, because I guess I'm a control freak, but not really. I don't know. I just, if I don't know about it, I get concerned about it until I know about it. And then I'm only slightly concerned about it. So that does help that, you know, it helps me and maybe it helps other people too, to just, you know, realize that, that people are doing everything that they can.
Yeah.
There's no known, like,
doing it. We're not like sanitizing stuff before we hand it to people or anything like that. You know, yeah. We're all mindful of our own cleanliness and personal hygiene and stuff like that.
It also doesn't live on surfaces, I heard. So
it keeps changing. Rabbit
hole alert, rabbit hole alert.
I sprayed the side of the cans, but I didn't spray the top of the can. And then, but it's been over 24 hours. I'm like, well, I'm sure it's fine. And then I'm sitting here drinking.
You're getting it tomorrow.
And then I go say hi to my wife.
No beer saves the world, right?
I go, Taryn, I'm drinking COVID. I fucking know it. These people are drinking. Yeah. It's also my irrational side and I have to let it out or else it just.
It's fine. We love you for it.
Yeah.
In a safe space right now.
Well, I heard you said no too. So, like, I mean, that's concerning. And if any of you have pre-existing conditions or anything, like, you're just doing what's best for you and your family, and that's all you can do.
That's what it should be. No, everybody can do what they need to do to their level of concern. You know,
and I don't know why, like, what you're saying, Brandon, it is a thing out here. And I've been sort of ranting about it for, like, all the Dr. Homebrew shows I've done and even this show a couple times. I don't understand. Like, I live across the street from a park. And the amount of people that interact with the strangers with no masks on is fucking baffling. And that sort of adds to my my insanity a little bit, because it's like, this is literally my only window to the world, right? We don't go to the store. Like, we
just get things delivered.
Yeah, so we see shit and we're like, what are you people doing? I don't understand it. And so then I think everybody else is doing that. But I have friends in New Jersey who, they go out to bars and, you know, they social distance or whatever, but they're living their life. And my friend Jeremy is like, we've been wearing masks since April. And I'm like, what does that feel like? Because I don't know what that feels like out here, because nobody does it.
Yeah. I think hopefully, like, this will be something we all learn from. Because remember, like, we'd see videos of, like, Asia, and they were all doing this 3 years ago, 4 years ago. They were just smarter. We need to be more cognizant of everyone's health around us. So, like, I want to start seeing people on BART wear a mask, you know.
Oh, my God. I'm going to do it.
Yeah. Hopefully, it becomes a cultural norm.
Yeah, if you're sick, wear your mask. Like, when you go to Tokyo, people are wearing masks when they're sick.
Well, I read some articles the other day that
this could be a great awakening for us. You know?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Ooh, don't say the great awakening. We'll start talking some QAnon shit, and I don't want to.
What is that? Is that a thing?
I don't follow that stuff, so I don't know.
Want a pepperoni pizza, Vito? Come on.
PizzaGate? Oh shit, we're talking PizzaGate.
Well, that's the same thing. Frazzle drip. It's a whole thing. We'll talk about it.
Yeah, I'm still away from all that.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, I read an article the other day that, like, the flu season in Europe sort of, like, ended 3 weeks or 4 weeks early because people are
because actually, they're wearing masks.
Yeah,
exactly. Wearing masks.
Let's not talk about that.
Positive, I think, that's going to come out of this is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Trying to say.
For sure. Yeah, yeah. Let's talk about the Tinky Tincture. Now,
those are beer.
Our Danville brewing episode. This is a beer that Vito brewed with our friend Matt.
Yeah.
This is the first time I'm having it. And I do like it. It's delightful. It's an IPA, sort of.
Yep.
I guess.
Yeah. Okay. I'll just kind of the same whole thing. We'll talk about. So before we opened, we did a bunch of collaborations with friends of mine that are now pro brewers. So they all gave me an opportunity to to do, I guess, marketing, beer, whatever. Get the word out there.
Yeah.
So to start, you know, this is before we were building the brewery, and they did collabs with us. So they were collabing with, you know, at that time, non-operating breweries. So that was cool. So what I wanted to do was pay that back and do collaborations with them once we were open, you know. So that's how this beer came about. When I think Matt, I think Tiki Drink. So immediately once we started talking, you guys know Matt. Yeah. So I'm like, Matt, Tiki Drink. I'm like, hey, dude, let's do it. And then what we had on the schedule was an IPA. So I had to do an IPA. And we had on the schedule like a hybrid IPA. So to me, what a hybrid IPA is you know, a little the wheat, oats, 01, finishes nice and dry, but it's got a little haze to it. So it's kind of like plays both sides of
finding.
no fining, yeah, and some hops to it. So I had to do that. So I was like, hey, Matt, let's do a tiki beer. And it was so funny. His first, like, kind of, he was very apprehensive. He's like, well, I don't want to just do a tiki beer just for the fucking sake of doing a tiki beer. And I'm like, no, dude, yeah, we're going to do it right. So we're like, put it down. Because, you know, a lot of breweries market tiki beer, and they're using some fruity hops or whatnot, and they're kind of cashing in on the whole tiki thing.
Oh, yeah.
And I agree with that as well. So I was like, all right, well, you know, what is a, you know, how are we going to do this? And we know we got to create this IPA. So he's like, let's do a tincture. One of his beers that he's done really well with is the oatmeal raisin cookie, which he's done a tincture with. So he's like, cool, let's kind of along that same line, we'll create this like rum based tincture and a grog drink. And it was actually based off, so for my birthday last year, he had a party and he made me a drink, a bumboat, I think it was called. You familiar with a bumboat?
I don't know whether I should say yes or no. I feel like it's a trick question.
It might be a trick question.
No, I've never heard of it.
It's a heavily pineapple grog drink. So it's like a pineapple grog drink. So we knew we had to have pineapple. And then making the tiki side or the tincture side of it. So it's like it's cinnamon, allspice berries, grapefruit peel, orange peel, vanilla. For the hops was like Sabro is what came to my mind. So you guys familiar with Sabro? So Sabro's got, to me, I get like a coconut lime pina colada. So it's got that vibe. So I was like, okay, cool. Let's go with that for the hops. And we had some Sabro left. So Sabro, only a pound and a half per barrel dry hop. So not by, you know, for my IPAs, I'm doing 3 to 4 pounds per barrel. So not aggressive by any means. Because we wanted the tincture to still shine through and be, and I think it is, it's the player. It's a spice beer. This is a spice beer for sure. Yeah. Like when you smell it, when you taste it. But you know, it's an IPA too. So it's, that's kind of the theme on that. So there's some oats, some wheat, Pilsner malt. Again, Pilsner malt is what I use a lot in my base. I just like Pilsner malt. I use that for a lot of IPAs.
Sure.
Yeah. And then 01 yeast.
I mean, it's a good beer, man. And I think the additions of the peels really help to sort of emphasize the bitterness of it too.
Yeah.
You know, because with in my mind, a tiki inspired beer shouldn't be too sweet.
Like no bitter. Yeah.
Sort of be. So you do need to make it a beer first. It's like we've ever talked about any time ever on the show where it's like, if you have an oak aged beer, it's a beer first.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the tiki drink beer is a beer first. So you do need to emphasize that, but some of these spices can kind of take away from it. So anyway, I like that play with the orange peel and the grapefruit peel or whatever you said. Whatever you said, I agree with.
Grapefruit and orange. You got it. You're listening.
Good. All right. Good. Yeah, it's good stuff. I could definitely taste the allspice for sure. I mean, to me, that sort of smell like allspice dram, which is a very tiki thing, and I like it. That's good.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm stoked off that one. I love how it turned out. Matt was stoked on how it turned out. So that was, you know,
everybody's loved it so far.
I really wanted to make him happy with the beer and proud of it. So he was, and everybody's loving it. So yeah, it's a really good, and just to get back to the collaborating, you know, people helped me get to where I'm at. Matt's a big person, you know, in that, a lot of these other breweries that we did these collabs with. So it was nice to bring them in, you know, wearing our masks that day. And being apart, you know, and having, you know, just that was really cool to bring them back in for those collabs.
Yeah, very cool, man. I like it. I like it. Well, it's good stuff. You guys are doing some killer shit over there, and you guys have food too.
Yeah,
I haven't been. This is my first time of really trying your beers. I mean, I had your beer. You have food to go.
Yeah, we do food to go.
Yeah. And food to go, Jason. Food to go.
We just got voted best new restaurant.
Yeah.
Oh, damn. All right. Congratulations.
Yeah.
It's worth it. Like, the kitchen staff is just as passionate about food as I am about beer. Yeah. And you're giving them the creative freedom, and you're challenging them to create new flavors.
Yeah, I checked out your webpage, and I saw your menu, and I was like, oh, my God. It's amazing. I mean, your food's wonderful.
Yeah, I think that's kind of like what our idea was of like the future of beer. Just like, I don't know, I guess the alcohol industry is there's
the market's flooded with good beer right now.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
You need something else. I think personally, just a lot of most people nowadays, especially like in my age bracket and above, probably are more fans of good dining and good alcohol.
Yes.
Pairing.
So that was just kind of the direction we saw things going in.
And they're using the beer and like, okay, some of the Strata Fresh Hops I brought back, I was like, here, take a couple pounds of this and make something with it. So they made like a spice that they just made some chicken wings with.
Yeah, so we made a Fresh Hop Strata lemon pepper seasoning for some wings that we're doing.
Is that total? Wow.
It's like bitter lemongrass from the hops. It's pretty good. Yeah. It turned out awesome.
They're killing it. They're all so creative and driven and passionate and about what they do.
We make everything from scratch, and like every day they're pouring beer into all of our different sauces, marinades,
making reductions,
whatever. Yeah.
Marinades.
They use a lot of the beer and stuff. So
I'm looking at your menu here, and I just appreciate the fact that you call hot dogs glizzies. Like, I think that, I'm like, God, because my buddy's from Philly, and he's like, bro, did you know he like told me this like last month, and suddenly it's everywhere. So your site. I'm like,
yeah. our GM, he's a little bit younger than me, but like he's hip to the new stuff, and he explained the meme and everything to us. And he's like, yo, we're gonna call him Glizzies. I'm like,
call him Glizzies.
That's awesome.
Gotta get the Glizzy game on. For sure. Well, I mean, that's marketing, though. That's what it takes. You know, it's like you're not being I don't know what the term is. You're not being insincere about it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? You're not just
paying respect to it. You're celebrating it. Yeah.
You're not taking the trend and then just and co-opting it. It's you know, you are young, hip people. Except Vito.
That makes sense.
Wow.
Collateral damage.
We're young and hip.
Hey, don't.
You know what I mean? Like that's your I don't know.
You know what I mean?
It's great. Yeah, you know what I mean? Anyway, I think we'll let you guys go. I think that's it. I think we've covered everything.
Yeah, for sure. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, of course. No, thanks for coming on. Yes, Vito.
You know what you think of that American Light Lager, JP?
Oh, I will, for sure.
PM us, we'll drop some beer off for you.
I dropped the beer off to your porch, so we'll deliver more. Yeah. We are shipping as well.
All right.
Yeah, cheaper than California.
We are shipping.
Yeah. How are you shipping? What's going on? How are you doing that? Order online shipping?
Yeah, we're just using GSO.
California?
In state only, California.
Yeah, they're getting a ton of business from breweries.
You go to the website and do that?
Yeah, yes. Yep. Yeah, you can go.
That was a softball plug.
Imperialbeer.com.
Okay. Imperialbeer.com.
Yeah, you can go to Instagram. If you go on Instagram, I think there's a link to our menu to place orders for pickup.
Okay.
On the Instagram, yeah.
We also hang out mostly on Instagram too. So if you have any questions or want to see pictures of food and stuff or DM us, like that's the place to do it for sure. Right.
Cool. I appreciate it. Well, thanks guys. Thank you very much.
This is awesome. This is great.
Yeah.
Right on, guys. We'll
see you later. All right, Sully, I think that's it, right? We're going to get out of here too.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're all here together, so I guess we all have to walk out the same door together.
All right, everybody, thanks a lot for supporting the show. Thanks a lot for listening to this program. If you want to hear other beer radio like this, of course, we have tons of shows online like Dr. Homebrew and Brew Strong and, you know, I don't know what else, actually. I think that's probably it. Intra Cerveza. So if you have any homebrewers in, you know, Mexico or Spanish-speaking areas that want to learn how to homebrew, that is the only show they should really be listening to, honestly. So anyway, check them all out on the network. Check out our friends at Imperiale. Go to imperialebeer.com. And if you're in California, you can order their beer, which I highly recommend. If you're going to come into town for whatever reason, welcome to East County. Put your mask on. Get to beer. All right. Thanks a lot, everybody. And we'll see you guys around.
Bye, guys.
Cheers. Thank you.